Welcome to latest TV news. I'm Mark Walker. Here are your headlines for today. We mark the sad death of His Royal Highness Prince Philip, Duke of Edinburgh. We have an exclusive interview with Paul Barber, Deputy Chairman and Chief Executive of Brighton Hove Albion Football Club. We have an interview with Councillor Mary Mears. Plus, we hear from the Green Party candidate for the position of Police and Crime Commissioner, Kahina Boussan. Firstly, His Royal Highness Prince Philip, the Duke of Edinburgh, sadly passed away yesterday at the age of 99. Our thoughts go out to the Queen and her family at this difficult time.
Buckingham Palace has announced that Prince Philip, husband of Queen Elizabeth II, has died aged 99 at Windsor Castle on Friday morning. The palace issued the statement at around midday on Friday the 9th of April, and the Queen spoke of her deep sorrow. The Duke of Edinburgh was the longest-serving consort. The flag at Buckingham Palace was lowered to half-mast following the death of Prince Philip, and floral tributes have been gathering outside the palace and at Windsor Castle. He made a unique contribution to the city of Brighton and Hove. This included paying a visit to Newhaven Fish Market in 2013 with the Queen, and in 2016 he officially opened the British Airways I-360 and expressed his interest in the engineering and innovation of the construction. Prince Philip was known for being frank and outspoken and for his unswerving loyalty to the Queen, who he was married to for 73 years.
We now have an exclusive interview with Paul Barber, Chief Executive and Deputy Chairman of Brighton and Hove Albion Football Club.
I'm Ian Hart, this is Latest TV, and this is One to One with Harty, an occasional series where I catch up with local personalities. My first guest is Mr. Paul Barber, Albion Chief Executive and Vice Chairman.
So we're going to talk about a multitude of subjects. We'll kick off, unfortunately, with COVID. And indirectly, it may allow clubs to effectively press the reset button and cut their financial cloth accordingly. That's a great sound move in theory. Reality, do you think that will actually happen, Paul?
Well, I think it has to happen to some extent because we've all run up tens of millions of pounds of losses, certainly in the Premier League and further down the pyramid. But as always, the biggest clubs and the best players will always find a way to bring transfers about, new contracts and movement in that respect. But I think there will be some kind of realignment around the rest of the pyramid. And I suspect we'll probably see more loan deals, for example, particularly further down the pyramid. And I think we'll probably see some shorter contracts because clubs won't want to be tied into longer term deals with a lot of uncertainty around their futures, not just immediate futures, but longer term futures, as some owners need to sell their clubs and some owners continue to struggle with COVID. So I think there will be some changes, but it's very, very hard to predict exactly where and when they'll take effect.
When do you think will be the next time we'll have 30,000 people in the ground?
I think probably the start of next season, if things go according to the government's plan. You know, we're certainly preparing for that. I think there's going to be a lot of work in between now and then with test events that we won't be part of, but hopefully we will have an opportunity to have some fans back at the Amex next month for Manchester City's visit, and then hopefully take some fans to the Emirates for the game at Arsenal. But certainly we're all gearing up to getting a full capacity back for the start of next season. And obviously there's going to be some challenges along the way. And no doubt, you know, as we've seen with this virus right the way from the start, there'll be some ups and downs to contend with as well. But hopefully we'll see 30,000 people back at the stadium in the not too distant future.
One of the Amex draws for me is the match day experience, not just what happens on the pitch, what happens off the pitch. Do you think we'll have a lot of changes to the match day experience we all enjoyed on the 29th of Feb 2020? Do you think there'll be drastic changes or there'll be changes that we will have to embrace as fans?
I think we've all got used to changes in our life over the last 12 months, you know, going to a coffee shop and getting a cup of coffee or going to the supermarket or going to the petrol station. You know, they're different experiences now to what they were like 12 months ago. And I don't think, you know, football will be any different. I think we'll see a number of issues that we'll all have to manage and deal with and frankly, just get on with if we want to watch football again. And that could involve a range of things. I think at the very least, we're going to be looking at photo ID for all fans. We're going to be looking potentially at medical questionnaires or some kind of vaccination passport or a negative test result to be able to get into the stadium come August. Whether that will all be in place or some of it will be in place, we wait to see. We wait to hear from the government on exactly what they want us to do. And similarly for May, I suspect we won't be in a position to have all of those things in place for that game against Manchester City, but I suspect we will certainly have some of it in place. So there will be a difference. It will probably mean getting to the ground earlier. It will probably mean being patient while checks are made on digital tickets, on photo IDs, and on, you know, making sure that people are fit and well enough to come into the stadium. So it's going to be different, Ian, but I think, you know, it's a relatively small price to pay to move towards some degree of normality. Whether it has to be in place forever, that remains to be seen. Whether we have different procedures in place going forward again, that remains to be seen. But I think we've all got to be prepared for some degree of difference when we come back to watch football.
Paul, I've got my second jab this afternoon down at Worthing Hospital. What are you going to do to the anti-vaxxer fans? Will you effectively ban anti-vaxxers from the Amex Stadium?
Well, I think it depends on what the government's policy is. You know, we've said right from the start of the pandemic, we will follow the government guidelines, whatever they happen to be. And in many cases, they're going to be enshrined in our safety certificate, which means that unless we're prepared to comply with them, we won't be able to open the stadium. So it's not really within the club's gift to determine what is and what isn't right for people. People have got to make their own minds up on the vaccine, as we all do as adults. I would hope that if people are not vaccinated, and there'll be a number of categories that aren't anti-vaccine, they're just simply not in a position to have the vaccine, whether it's through age or pregnancy or whatever other condition they might have, that there'll be an option for people to take a test, provided that they can show a negative test. And I can't see any reason why that can't be an alternative to the vaccine. But I suspect we will all be subject to either proof of vaccine or proof of a negative test, and certainly in the early stages of coming back.
It's been shown football is nothing without fans. Now, the Albion appreciate their fans. Do you think COVID will make the other 91 clubs appreciate their fans as much as the Albion do?
Well, I mean, I've worked in football now for 25 years, and I've got to say, Ian, I've never taken part in a meeting with other clubs where fans haven't been top of the agenda. I think it's one of those strange myths that builds up that football clubs don't care much for fans or don't want fans or don't appreciate fans. For me, I've never experienced that in 25 years working in the game. I've never been in a meeting where fans haven't been discussed. So I don't believe that you know, there is any issue there. Clearly, some clubs have better facilities, some clubs have better policies, some clubs treat their fans better than others. But I think every club that certainly that I've ever worked at or been involved with or been in meetings with know what fans bring to the game. And that goes for broadcasters as well. The broadcasters understand fully that fans not being in the stadium has completely changed the TV experience as well as the live match day experience for players. And I think we all can't wait to get our stadiums full again. It's what we exist for. You know, professional football is nothing without fans. It is just a game of football that could be being played anywhere, albeit a higher level than most of us are able to play. But with fans in the stadium, it's transformed. And the Amex particularly, I think, is transformed with fans in the stadium. And we're looking forward to it, you know, hugely. And, you know, roll on next month if we can get 25% of our capacity back in. That's going to be fantastic. And even better for August if we can move ahead with a full stadium.
I have to say, though, watching a game in an empty ground has made me appreciate what a quality player Adam Lallana is, because he's like Brian Moore. He basically commentates the whole game. He's talking constantly, updating people. He's just a superb asset. We just need to keep him fit, don't we, for 38 games a season.
Yeah, I mean, these are the sorts of things, you know, that I suppose we are lucky enough to see in training on a very regular basis. So we know the kind of influence that certain players have on the pitch. And very often that is something that fans can't see. It's a dimension that that fans lack, just simply because the stadium atmosphere, ironically, takes that away, or the TV experience takes that away. But Adam is a great leader. But, you know, as you would have heard, Ian, there's a number of players out there that are very vocal, not afraid to, you know, to put their opinion across. But Adam is certainly a good leader. Danny Welbeck is another one who is different, but has a number of leadership qualities as well, and experience of the game. And obviously Lewis is a quieter captain than some, but leads by example. And again, these sort of things you get to focus on a little bit more when you haven't got the noise of 30, 40, 50, 60,000 people ringing in your ears. You are able to sort of watch and listen a lot more intently to what's actually happening on the pitch itself, as opposed to being distracted by what might or might not be happening in the crowd. So it has been a different experience, but I for one can't wait to get back to crowds in the stadium.
Thank you for watching. Join me next time.
That's it for the first half. Join me for the second half for a discussion with Councillor Mary Mears and the Green Party candidate for Police and Crime Commissioner. Welcome back to Latest TV News. I'm Mark Walker. And now for that discussion with Councillor Mary Mears on local issues. Here it is.
I'm here with Conservative Councillor for the Rottingdean Coastal Ward, Mary Mears. Welcome back, Mary. We're going on to planning issues. They take up a lot of councillors' time, actually, don't they, planning issues? And it seems a lot more kind of development is taking place on people wanting to expand where they live rather than move out of Brighton. That seems to be the trend at the moment.
Absolutely, and actually it's cheaper for people to extend their properties, yeah, than try to move. And not only is it cheaper, but obviously there's a limited number of properties, perhaps in somebody's price range, that they would be able to move to. And if they're a family and they've got children in school, it's all the things they have to consider going forward. So yes, there's an awful lot on planning going. It's one of those wards that planning, I would say, is one of the key issues that ward councillors deal with. Well, put it another way, one ward councillor deals with, because two of my ward councillors sit on planning, so they get to see the final part when it's on the planning committee.
Yeah.
I get all of the rest of it.
Yeah, exactly. So what are the issues over there? Is it? I know there's a lot of housing development going on at the back of Salt Dean there, isn't there?
Yeah.
You know, near where there's horses and out the back there.
Yeah, there's two, actually. There was one at Falmer Avenue, and there's also another one coming forward at Coombe Farm. I mean, yeah. I have an issue around building on urban fringe. I think it's very short-sighted. Once you concrete something over, you need to be very, very careful, bearing in mind that the climate's changing and we're going to be exposed to far more wet weather, you know, around flooding. So I don't particularly, well, I never have supported urban fringe development. But we've also got a couple coming up Wednesday, one particular one in Ovingdean that was a big planning application a while back, and now it... The developer sold it to another developer. It's coming up on Wednesday for virtually half of what was being proposed. But the interesting thing about it is that they're going for conditions of change of plans, because the original planning application, they now say, is not doable because the roads didn't work. But we told them all that at the very beginning on the first application. So a bit of common sense coming in there. So that's quite helpful. We've also got other planning applications, and I think the world's different from where it was perhaps a few years ago, because there's a real issue around climate change, and particularly the National Trust, they've done a big piece on climate change and coastal erosion, and they're proposing to plant over 20 million trees particularly. And we must remember, we have planning applications coming in Rottingdean that run through but then end up near the cliffs, and we need to be very careful going forward now about what is given planning permission for the future. It may have been all right, yeah, in the past, but there's a different world, there's a different conversation going on about climate change, and we need to be really mindful that we're not just building and concreting over that will have adverse effects in the future.
Yeah. What is it? I mean, people never really like, kind of houses being extended next to them, because people like to keep things as they are. But is it the kind of permitted development that you can now have? Is that causing a bit of a few problems, you think, with neighbours, you know, maybe not getting on before, and then people carrying out development work, you know, particularly in their back garden?
The majority of just extensions and developments within communities are fine. I think the pandemic, if I'm honest, has highlighted people are at home a lot more.
Yeah.
Whereas perhaps they never would have been before. So things are more relevant and more noticeable to them. So I think that is all part of why people are uncomfortable about certain developments. But I think there needs to be a balance.
Yeah.
If it's doable and it doesn't have a massive adverse effect and people need to extend their property, okay, but if it does, then it needs to be questioned to make sure perhaps it needs just slightly adjusting so everybody can live with it.
All right, we're going to leave it there. That's it. Thank you, Councillor Mary Mears, for the Rottingdean Coast Award. Thanks a lot, and all the best.
Finally, I spoke to the Green Party councillor, candidate for the Police and Crime Commissioner, Kahina Boussan. Here's the story.
So I'm joined here today by Kahina Boussan, and you are the Green Party candidate for the Police and Crime Commissioner role. Kahina, just tell us a bit about the elections coming up on the 6th of May, because not everyone will know that there's going to be an election. So there's and a bit about what the Police and Crime Commissioner does. But first of all, introduce yourself.
Hi. So, yeah, as you said, my name is Kahina Boussan and I'm standing for Police and Crime Commissioner. It's really exciting, actually. It's an election that not many people turn out for. As you said, a lot of people don't really know that much about it or don't sort of think about it. But it's a really important role because the role is responsible for holding the police to account to the public.
Yeah.
So it's a role that makes sure that the police are serving the public in the way that they're meant to do. So and that's been a really hot topic over the last year and even just over the last week. So I'm hoping that this is something that will really get people engaged in this conversation about policing and about the best way to do that and how it can best serve the people. So yeah, the election is on the 6th of May. It's the same day as local elections. So if you're in Brighton, there's also by-elections in Hollingdean and Stammer and Patcham, and across Sussex, there's council elections as well.
Yeah, exactly. The Police and Crime Commissioner, one of their main roles is they kind of set the priorities, don't they? The police and priorities for Sussex Police. We're dealing with Sussex Police here. But they also, obviously, their ultimate power, I guess, is to dismiss the Chief Constable in exceptional circumstances. Not sure that's ever happened with the Police and Crime Commissioner, but that's their general powers, aren't they?
Yeah, that's right. So it's not just, it's about setting priorities, but the way that the Police and Crime Commissioner does that is through budget. So it's really important about setting the priorities through the budget, because it's the decision as to which areas get more funding and which areas get less. So, you know, been something that's been coming up a lot recently is women's safety, and investing in areas of women's safety is something that the Police and Crime Commissioner has the power to do.
Exactly. Just tell us a bit about yourself then. What's your background, and how do you propose to make a difference? The current candidate, the current sitting Police and Crime Commissioner, who I think served an extra year because of the COVID pandemic, is Katie Bourne, of course.
Yeah, that's right. So my background is quite mixed. I started off working as a tour guide in an art gallery, which I'm currently caretaker for as well. But my main experience is in communications, so press, journalism, that kind of stuff. But recently I made the move to education. So for the last year, I've been working in a specialist school for autism out in mid-Sussex. And I work there as a teaching assistant, really supporting the learning of these students that need those sort of special educational measures.
Yeah, carry on. And so that's really important work, isn't it? Particularly during the pandemic, Kahina, that's been crucial, hasn't it? And we know that young people have, they've really suffered during the lockdown, particularly this third lockdown we're currently in.
Yeah, the students at the school that I work at are particularly vulnerable, and because of that, they've been at school throughout. So when other people have been in lockdown and they haven't, you know, a lot of our children haven't been able to go to school, these children have been continuing to go to school. So since September, I've still been consistently working throughout the pandemic as if everything is as normal, although of course with COVID safe measures.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. How would you assess what Sussex Police, what's currently happening? What would you do differently? We should say that Sussex Police is divided into three districts, isn't it? I think it's West, East Sussex, and then Brighton Hove has its own policing area.
Yeah, that's right. I think the key priority here, and I've said it over and over again, is that policing at the moment is really unfair in Sussex. That's something I keep coming back to, and it's the reason that I'm running, because I can't, like many people, I can't sit by and let things that are unjust just carry on. We saw over the summer the Black Lives Matter protests. In Sussex, Black people are 10 times more likely to be stopped and searched than white people. That is an appalling statistic. In fact, I actually put that put a question about what was being done about that to Katie Bourne at the Sussex Police and Crime Panel on Friday. And it's an understatement to say that her response was quite lacking and quite disappointing. There was one moment where she did refer to it as proportionate, which is extremely disappointing. And I think it shows that we need a fresh voice. We need change in our police system. We need someone who's willing to stand up for groups that are not being heard. Another group that we've already touched on is women. Women are just simply not safe in Sussex. And that's a really disappointing thing to have to say out loud, especially as a woman myself. But when you look at the statistics, they're just appalling. There are 1,540 rapes recorded in Sussex in 2019, and only 58 of those resulted in a conviction. That is astonishingly low.
Brilliant. Okay, Kahina, Busan, thank you for speaking to us today, and all the best for the campaign. Catch up again soon.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, thanks.
That's it for today. Join me for tomorrow for more of your local news stories. Goodbye.